Well, here we are.
At home.
In our living rooms.
With our families.
With those we love.
Today, wherever you are located,
know that you are not alone.
You are not alone.
We're still connected.
Today, we gather as one body.
One body.
One body.
Because the church is not a building.
It never has been.
It never has been.
We gather today as one church.
One church.
To lift up one name.
The name of Jesus.
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 So wherever you are,
today is the day the Lord has made.
Today is the day to give Him thanks.
So let's unite. Let's worship.
Let's praise His name.
For He is worthy of it today
and every day.
Because we are still the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
Welcome to this online service with Trinity Church. If this is your first time visiting, we extend a special welcome to you, and we trust that you'll enjoy worshiping with us. Depending upon when you are watching, you will notice that we are meeting in person this Sunday, May 31st, and albeit we're meeting outside. This site has a set of guidelines which are important and worthwhile reading. And they are there to keep us all healthy. And as we move forward, we trust that you will be able to look at them, read them, and follow what has been placed there. At this time, we are asking those in the congregation to please RSVP to an email that you should receive if you plan on attending one of these in-person services, so we can plan accordingly. As we have said in the past here, there are many other ministries that continue online, and we invite you to stay tuned to this video after Pastor Chris's message. Well, as we worship together, here are a few verses from Psalm chapter 9. Psalm 9. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. And those who know your name put their trust in you, for you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, even in these uncertain and difficult times, we give thanks to you for all your wonderful deeds. We thank you that you are sovereign and in control of every situation. We thank you that you are indeed a stronghold in times of trouble. You do not forsake those who put their trust in you. Lord, may our praise rise up to you as we worship you through our songs and hearing from your word. It is your word that instructs us and encourages us. Give Pastor Chris freedom to explain and apply your word to our lives, and may our hearts be receptive. And we pray this in the worthy name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
I see your grace from the mountain. I felt you there in the valley below. I see your love and your mercy. You're guiding me home. I feel your hand bringing peace, control. love is my anchor. You're my only home. You're my only home. And I will trust in you. I will not be low. High on the mountain, I will be lifting my voice. And in the valley, I will be dancing for joy. In every season, rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Then in Him be found, blessed in His righteousness alone, the faultless stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Trinity Church Online. And, we are going to continue our series in the book of 1 Thessalonians, looking at the idea of certainty in uncertain times. We've been going through the first two chapters. We're going to wrap up chapter 2 this morning as we continue to look and dig into what Paul was speaking to the Thessalonians, the Thessalonian church at this time. And what we're looking at specifically this morning is that we can be certain of the fellowship of believers. And so we're going to kind of unpack what that means, what that looks like. It's one of those church terms you hear all the time. You might be sitting there hearing this and being like, well, what exactly do you mean by fellowship of believers? And we're going to kind of unpack that. But, you know, the thing about the fellowship of believers, when you talk about biblical fellowship and this picture of what God has done for us through His Son, Jesus Christ, is that we have been adopted into His family. When you place your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ, you believe that He died on the cross for your sins, that He rose again to conquer sin, to conquer death, that He took your place, that He offers that forgiveness for those sins in order to bridge that divide that exists between us as sinners and God as holy. There is a connection that we experience because once we are adopted into that the family of God and we become brothers and sisters in the Lord, that's what we're talking about when we say the fellowship of believers. We're not talking about necessarily a local fellowship in particular, but it can mean that. But more broadly, it is all believers everywhere. And it's amazing the connections that happen through that. When you know the Lord and you have placed your faith and trust in Him as your Savior, you know, there's a saying from, you know, Moody Bible Institute, that the sun never sets on a Moody grad. That's kind of the kind of saying that people throw out there. It's one of the slogans they have there because one of the prides of Moody is that they have people all over the world ministering, at any given time. And so no matter where you look when the sun is up, there is somebody in every corner of the world that has some affiliation with Moody. And, you know, we got to experience that in multiple different times. Once, you know, when I was fresh out of college and my wife and I were in the Bahamas and we were walking down the street and heard someone yell my name and I turn around. It wasn't just somebody from, you know, also from Moody. It was somebody from my floor at Moody. And that was just amazing to see. And then just this past summer when we were overseas
And we were out in Indonesia, and one of the things that we saw was we met another Moody grad who had gone to Moody the same time that we were there. And it's just, it's amazing the connections and the stories that you have when you hear that person went to the same school as you. And, you know, you see that other ways. And so just can imagine the power of the connection that we experience through the blood of Jesus Christ. It trumps any connection we would have about where you went to school or what sports team you root for or where you go to church or what community you're from or any of those things. Those things pale in comparison. All those places where we find some form of identity just fade into the background and they're overshadowed by the truth of the identity that we have and the shared identity that we have through as sons and daughters of Jesus Christ, of the Father, through the blood of Jesus Christ. And so that's kind of what we're going to be looking at here this morning, that we can be certain of that fellowship. And Paul speaks to it in regards to the Thessalonians in chapter 2, in verses 17 to 20. And so here's what he says. It says, "But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time, in person, not in heart, we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face, because we wanted to come to you. I, Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? For you are our glory and joy." And so when we start to kind of look at this, the being certain of the fellowship of believers, we see this connection that comes through what Jesus did for us and through finding, having our identity changed by the blood of Jesus Christ on that cross. And so that connection of fellowship is what we're looking at this morning. And we want to look at three attributes of that connection. And the first is that the connection of fellowship is not about physical proximity, but proximity of the heart. And so as we pick this up in verse 17, this is what he says, "But since we were torn away from you, brothers..." And so right away, we see this picture and we go back into our memories and we look at what we've studied over the previous several weeks and we know exactly what he's talking about. That Paul, through the account in the book of Acts of founding the Thessalonian church, was there. He was pouring himself into ministering to them, to founding the church, trying to disciple them. And there was opposition. There were members of the community that didn't want them there. And so they started to cause problems. They ultimately caused a riot to break out. And Paul and Silas and Timothy had to flee to a different city. And that's what you see where Paul's coming from here. He's saying, you know what, since we were torn away from you. And I love that, the word, when you start to break some of these things down in the original language, it uncovers so much. That word for torn away is basically put together two Greek words. The first one is a preparation that means from or away from, and it speaks of a rupture of a former relationship or a separation of one thing from another. And the second word is the word for orphan. It's orphanos, and it's literally a child deprived of one or possibly both parents. It means to be made or caused to be an orphan, and when it's used figuratively in Scripture, it speaks of an unwanted separation, as when one is torn away from, deprived of contact and society, or unwillingly separated from. Now, I don't know if any of you can relate to that. You know, sometimes we try to find illustrations to explain things. And other times when you look at this word, it's like I think every single one of us can relate to being, you know, to experiencing unwanted separation, being deprived of contact in society, or being unwillingly separated from. And that's something we've experienced over the past several months, and some people are still experiencing it as we continue to deal and navigate this pandemic. And Paul is speaking very differently. He had experienced this being torn away from the Thessalonians due to persecution, but maybe you're sitting there, you say, hey, you know what, I understand this. I crave this fellowship. I crave the sense of community that comes with that. But the thing to remember is it's not about physical proximity. It's about the proximity of the heart. He continues on. He says, "But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time, in person, not in heart." That phrase "in person" literally means to one's front or their face. And so what Paul is saying is we haven't been able to see you face to face. We haven't been able to be there with you, but not in heart. Our hearts have never left you. He's telling the Thessalonians, our hearts have been with you throughout everything you've been going through. Because the Thessalonian church was now facing the same persecution that Paul faced and Silas and Timothy faced when they were there and they were ministering. And so that's what Paul's kind of unpacking here. He says, you know what? We've been torn away from you. It's only been a short time, but it was in person, but not in heart. Because the thing about the connection that we experience through the blood of Jesus Christ, through what he did for us when we place our faith and trust in him, is that there is nothing that can separate that heart connection. Because it's about the proximity of the heart. Even when we are forced to be apart and when we are separated, we are together and we can experience that fellowship in different ways. But here's the thing what Paul says. He continues on and he says in verse 17, he says, we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face. That phrase, to endeavor more eagerly, it conveys the idea of hurrying to do something. It implies the associated energy, intense effort, and motivation. It suggests zealous concentration and diligent effort. In other words, one's best effort. The verb speaks of intensity of purpose followed by intensity of effort. In other words, what Paul's saying here is, look, we endeavored the more eagerly. He doesn't say we desired the more eagerly. He doesn't say we necessarily just wanted. We thought about being with you. He says we tried. We have tried everything to be together, and yet we can't. But don't forget that we cannot be separated in heart. Because that is we have this connection that comes through what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. And that can be taken away by no man, by no persecution, by no pandemic. That can never separate us from each other. Just as the Bible tells us, we can never be separated from the love of God. And he wraps that verse up by saying, you know, we desire to see you, not just desire to see you, but we desire to see you face to face. In other words, he says, you know what, there is value in this. We don't just want to hear about you and hear about your growth, but we want to see it. We want to be able to contribute to it. We want to be with you, and it speaks to Paul's heart for discipleship. He wasn't content just to preach and run. That was what people were accusing him of. They were saying, you know what, he was here, he preached, he wanted to get paid, and then he wanted to get out. He wanted fame, he wanted this, and he left. He doesn't care about you. He doesn't matter to him what happens to the church here. And Paul's speaking directly against that. He's saying, you know what, look, we want to see you face to face, not just to be able to see you, but because we want to be a part of your lives. But we are connected. We are part of the same fellowship, and you can be certain of that. You see, Paul was pained by his separation from the Thessalonians. It hurt him. For him, he felt like they were a family that was torn apart. He felt orphaned. He felt orphaned here. It's as if his children had been ripped away, because that's what they were. They were his spiritual children. He cares for them. He's invested time, his efforts in their well-being, but now he's not able to be with them. And they're away from his presence, but he stresses over and over that they are not for a moment out of his thoughts. When you start to think about this practically, Paul really loved them. He cared about them. And he's saying he cared about all of them. He loved all of them. And, you know, if you've ever experienced being in ministry, or if you've ever experienced just life in general, you know, there's things about life that make loving some people difficult. And Paul is saying, you know what? There are people that are difficult to love at times, but the fellowship of the blood of Christ, what he did for us on the cross, trumps all of that. It supersedes that. And you know what? Jesus loved them. Jesus loves everyone. Well, you know, you think about it, you know, many of us are hard to love because of different things that we have that have happened to us, or the different nuances or different quirks that we have. God loved the Thessalonian church and their awkwardness and their oddness, and Paul does too. Paul learned to do it too, and he is deeply caring for them. And he wants to see them face to face. Well, now you might be asking the question, well, why isn't he able to? The persecution was there before. Why can't he then go back? And he says, you know, we were torn away from you. We didn't want to be, but then we get into verse 18. In verse 18, it says, because we wanted to come to you, I, Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered us. And that brings us to the second point. The second thing about the connection of fellowship is, first, it's not about physical proximity, but proximity of the heart. And second, it's something to be sought after. Just as Paul was pained by not being able to be with the Thessalonians, now we see that he's frustrated by being prevented from doing what he feels is right. He knows that he feels like he desires to be there, to be with them, to be part of their lives, to be part of their growth. And yet, you know, he realizes he's not been able to do it. But he also is looking at the reasons for that. And he uses the term he wanted. He says, because we wanted to come to you. This is not just we thought about it, like we said before. He wanted. It's a desire that it's intense. It implies a decision of will. That we weren't just saying, oh, it would be nice to go and visit. I mean, we've all had those conversations with our families, haven't we? I mean, even right now, in the midst of what we're dealing with in a pandemic, so many of us look around and say, it would be nice to be able to go and do this. But we also recognize some of the realities, and we haven't necessarily gone and made plans to do some of those things because we don't know, what kind of restrictions are going to be in place in the, you know, moving forward in the coming days and weeks. So we a lot of times have pulled away from planning certain things. Paul's saying, look, we wanted to come to you. There was an exercise of will and purpose. This idea of wanting meant that we were trying to make it happen. It wasn't just some kind of whim or whimsy. We wanted to come to you. He says again and again. It's literally both once and again. So it wasn't just one time, and then the plans kind of fell apart. They were thwarted. But no, he said we planned it again. And again, and we tried again, and yet it still didn't happen. And then he says, why? He says, you know what? I, Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered us. That word hindered is an interesting Greek word there. It's the word ekopto, and it means to knock or cut into, to impede one's course by cutting off his way, and then hinder, impede, thwart, or interrupt. It means to make progress slow or difficult. It can also convey the idea of a delay. And so what Paul is kind of saying there is, you know, we've been delayed. We're still attempting to do this. John MacArthur explains it this way. He says that ekopto is a military term referring to the digging of a trench or breaking up of a road. One of the countermeasures an ancient army would take against the opposition was to dig a massive trench that would prevent enemy troops from reaching its men. Another way to frustrate the enemy's progress would be to tear up a brick or stone road so that he could not traverse it. Thus, Paul depicted the powerful devil as supernaturally obstructing the apostle's strong desire to revisit Thessalonica. You know, the idea of the fellowship that he's looking at with Thessalonian believers is something to be sought after. It's powerful. This connection we have because of what Jesus Christ did for us, we can be certain of it no matter what, whether we are together or separate. But it is something we should seek after. It's something to be desired. You know, when you start to think of stories, when you start to think of, you know, maybe as you've been in quarantine and different things, you've spent time watching movies or reading books or some of the, you know, these different things. For my son, he's been getting into Star Wars lately and I've been reading him Lord of the Rings. And when you start to think of those stories, those are just epic stories of good versus evil. And they all have at the core the value of pursuing doing the right thing when it's difficult, in the face of overwhelming opposition, in the face of being hindered, that you continue to push on, you continue to have hope. In the Lord of the Rings, Frodo needed to destroy the ring, even though this put him in mortal danger over and over and over again. He continued to persevere and to push because he understood and knew that it was the right thing to do. In Star Wars, Luke needs to go and confront Darth Vader to try to draw the good in him out, even though it's putting him in mortal danger. If you've seen those movies, I won't try to spoil them for you, or the books, they're both very, you know, rather old, so hopefully it's not a spoiler alert there you need at this moment, but needless to say, there's great dangers being faced, but yet, one of the driving forces of both of those stories, and of so many stories of this good versus evil picture, is the hope. It's hope. And, you know, when we talk about the fellowship, the connection that we have with one another as believers in Jesus Christ, you know, that fellowship is something to be sought after and to be nurtured. Paul was frustrated because he couldn't do what he thought was right, which was to be with the Thessalonians. And so he did what he could do, which was to write to them. And then later on in the next chapter, we're going to see that he was so wanting to be with them that he goes ahead and sends Timothy to be with them and to check on them and to get a report back to him. It's something to be sought after. It's something to be sought after. There's power there. And then the third thing, when we think about the fellowship and the connection that we have through fellowship, is that it's part of the reward. It's part of the reward. See, Paul rejoices in the fact that he can glory in the Thessalonians' faith. And so when we look at the last two verses of the chapter, verses 19 and 20, here's what he says. For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? For you are our glory and joy. When you start to look at some of the commentaries on 1 Thessalonians, a lot of people believe that it would probably have been a better chapter break to end chapter 2 after verse 16, because verse 17 through 20 kind of leads into chapter 3. And yet, most likely the chapter break is at that spot because they end every chapter in 1 Thessalonians with a reference to Jesus' second coming. And so there it is, right there, right in front of him. And so Paul is talking about the fact that the Thessalonians' faith and the fellowship, the connection that Paul has to them, is in and of itself part of the reward. And we hear that all the time when we talk about working for the Lord and serving the Lord. Well, there's rewards. You know, Jesus talked about storing for ourselves rewards and treasures up in heaven. And you hear this all the time. And so Paul is going kind of beyond that, saying, look, you are part of this. You are part of the reward. You are the reward itself. And he uses three different terms. It says, for what is our hope? The first term he uses is hope. And so as we kind of look at this, Warren Wiersbe says it this way. It says, Paul did not look back and give in to regret and remorse because he couldn't be with them. Instead, he looked ahead and rejoiced. For the Christian, the best is yet to come. Paul looked ahead by faith and saw his friends in the presence of Jesus Christ in glory. In times of trouble and testing, it is important that we take the long view of things. Paul lived in the future tense as well as in the present. His actions were governed by what God would do in the future. He knew that Jesus Christ would return and reward him for his faithful ministry, and on that day, the saints from Thessalonica would bring glory to God and joy to Paul's heart. And so we mentioned these three things. The first one is hope, the second one is joy, and the third one is a crown of boasting. So hope is defined here as a desire for some future good with the expectation of obtaining it. You know, hope is not just like, hey, I think this might happen. It is confident expectancy. It is believing earnestly that it will happen. Hope is the looking forward to something with some reason for confidence regarding its fulfillment. There's an author named K.M. Wayland, and she has a quote about hope, and I love this quote when I came across it. She says this, hope is not some namby-pamby good feeling. Hope is difficult. Hope is ferocious. It is a phoenix clawing its way up from the ashes. It is powerful for the very reason that it requires tremendous courage. You think about that. It requires tremendous courage to hope. And as the believer, our hope is in Jesus Christ and what he's done for us. And for Paul, when he says that the Thessalonians were his hope, he's saying, you know what, you are our hope. You know, what is our hope and our joy and our crown of boasting? You are. And so he's essentially saying that Jesus is living through them, and you are our hope. You know, you are the one that we're looking forward to seeing when this whole thing is over. And we do it with confident expectancy, because we know that when the time comes, we will see each other again, even if we never meet again here on this earth. The second word he uses that says, what is our hope or joy? John MacArthur talks about joy this way. He says, a great part of heaven's bliss for the redeemed will be the joyful presence of those whom they have been used to reach. The believer's hope of such reward is in part what Jesus in his parable of the unjust steward alluded to. Make friends for yourselves by means of the wealth of unrighteousness, so that when it fails, they will receive you into the eternal dwellings. That's Luke 16:9. Even as the unbelieving steward or manager used his master's resources to purchase earthly friends, Christ said believers should use the resources of their master, provides to bring people to salvation. Whether or not believers know those people now as friends, they will know them in glory as friends forever and sources of eternal joy. The time to receive in full the promised joys is still in the future at Christ's return. So Paul is, you know, alluding to this, that, hey, our hope and our joy is what's coming when Jesus returns. And he's going to get into that here more in a second. And then the next one, the crown of boasting. And so that word crown is an interesting word. It refers, we hear crown, and maybe you think of, like, you know, like I said, we've been stuck at home and we've been watching a lot of TV. So maybe if you have children and you have like Disney Plus or something, you may think of like princess movies or a king, and you think of a crown of, you know, like that. Or you might think of a crown of thorns, like if you're thinking in terms of biblically. What Paul's talking about here, the word here, refers to a wreath or a garland that was given as a prize to the victors in public games and was thus a symbol of honor. It's the Greek word stephanos, and it's in the classical Greek it was used of the kingly crown. But in the Bible, they use a separate word for a king's crown, which is the word for diadem. And that's where we get that term. You might hear that in some of the old hymns. And so he's not referring to a king's crown here. He's referring to the crown of victory for participating in a race or running in a race or in winning that. And so it was the victory, a crown of victory in games of civic worth, military valor, nuptial joy, festival gladness, and it was used as a wreath or a garland that would be placed on someone's head. And notice what he says. Paul doesn't say that he would receive a crown. Though this is kind of suggested in the text. What Paul's saying here is interesting. He said that the saints of Thessalonica themselves would be his crown when he met them at the judgment seat. You see, he's saying that this fellowship that he has, the connection he has to the Thessalonians, because of being able to minister to them, being able to share his faith, to share the gospel with them, and to see them accept that, to see the gospel take root and sprout in their lives, and then to watch them grow, and now at this point from far away to hear about their growth, he is saying, you know what? That in and of itself, you are the crown that I will receive. You are the reward for running this race in this life. How many of us can look at things like that in our own lives, can look at the people we minister to and realize, you know what, it's not about receiving rewards in heaven, because the people we are ministering to, when we see them at that second coming, that is in and of itself reward enough, and yet it is implied that we will receive more than that. The Stephanos was the only prize an ancient Olympic athlete received. You start a little going back to the ancient Olympics. You know, nowadays we talk about the Olympics. We think about, I mean, you watch, the Olympic medal ceremony. They have medals. They have flowers. Sometimes they do have those wreaths that are hung around their necks. In the ancient Olympics, they didn't get medals. All they got was that crown, that wreath that was placed upon their head. And Paul says here it's a crown of boasting. That word boasting means an act of taking pride in something. And so what Paul's saying here is, you are my wreath. You are my crown, he's saying to the Thessalonians. I'm not looking for any other prize. I'm not in this for anything else. This goes right back to him defending his ministry. It says, you are the trophy I will give to God one day. I love that. And they were. Paul told them about Jesus. He led them to the faith. He discipled them for the short period he was with them. And he has seen them grow up to be strong believers, to be strong followers of Christ. He's proud of them, and he's going to be thrilled to show them off to the Heavenly Father when that comes, when that time comes. And when will that time come? He lays that out here too. Before our Lord Jesus at his coming. At his coming, that's the word parousia, and it speaks of the personal presence of a person. Makes sense, right? The personal presence of a person. That sounds like a, you know, kind of the Department of Redundancy Department kind of definition there. In addition, it's used to speak of the coming of a person and his arrival or advent. And in Paul's day, it was commonly used in the Hellenistic world for the formal visits of royalty. Paul's saying this is not just something Jesus is going to throw together at the last minute. It's planned. It's organized. And he is coming back. It's a formal visit of royalty that Jesus himself, at his coming, then we will be gathered together again and I can present you to him. Because you are my crown. You are my crown of boasting. You are my hope. You are my joy. And then the last verse in the chapter, verse 20, says, is it not you? And then verse 20, for you are our glory and joy. And so Paul all of a sudden changes tenses here. It's interesting because all this talk about the Thessalonians being his hope and his joy and his boast, crown of boasting, that's all talking about when the second coming happens. When Jesus comes again and he arrives and he calls his people home. But then Paul says something interesting, for you are our glory and joy. It's in the present tense, which means that the believers at Thessalonica continually were already a source of joy, a source of glory to Paul. The fact that they would be in heaven with him, you know, together to see Jesus face to face would also be an eternal source of those things. But for the moment, Paul sees the victory as already having happened. And their continual growth in their faith was presently enough to sustain Paul. And I don't know if you guys can see the power of the connection there. That Paul was looking at the Thessalonian believers and saying, you know what, we are connected by something greater than ourselves, that no distance can separate us from each other, no persecution can keep us apart. Because at the end of the day, when this life is over, we're going to be together. God's promised that. Jesus has promised that. And you, and watching you grow, you are my hope. You are my joy. You are the thing that I can boast about. Warren Wiersbe summarizes all of chapter 2 of 1 Thessalonians by saying this: when the Christians at Thessalonica read this letter, it must have encouraged them tremendously. They were going through intense persecution and suffering, and perhaps some of them were tempted to give up. Don't give up, Paul encouraged them. Lay hold of the spiritual resources you have in Jesus Christ. You have the Word of God within you, the people of God around you, and the glory of God before you. There is no need to give up. Maybe you're feeling that way right now. Maybe you're frustrated because you can't be around people you care about, or you can't be together with the people, with your brothers and sisters in Christ, let alone your brothers and sisters in families at times. Maybe it's distance that's separating you. I don't know. Maybe, you know, you are just feel like you're in the gutter. You know, Oscar Wilde had a great quote about, he said, all of us are in the gutter. Some of us just look up and see stars. Just an awesome picture of hope. Maybe you feel like you've lost that hope. And maybe you need to hear the message Paul had for the Thessalonians. Because that message that Paul has for the Thessalonians, he would speak about you and me, and Jesus himself would speak this message to us as well. Because so many people that Paul has never even fathomed the reach that God would use his life and his writings, inspired by the Holy Spirit, to speak truth and to speak life into so many of us. You might be frustrated. You might be in pain. You might be in despair. Don't give up. You have the Word of God within you, the people of God around you, whether they're physically present around you or not, they are always around you in heart. And the glory of God before you. There is no need to give up. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to open your word. Lord, we ask you just speak to our hearts through your word this morning, Father. My prayer as always is that you would move me aside and just, Lord, you would impact someone's heart and life through this, through your word. Father, we are in a situation where we are at times separated, and in an era of social distancing and quarantines and things of that nature, Lord, it can be frustrating. I mean, we look at this passage, I think we can relate to this picture of being torn away from those that we care about, from being torn away from those that we care and love. And for many of us as believers, it has to do with our church family, with those that we worship with and that we've grown to love and care about. Paul was speaking directly to the Thessalonians. Maybe each and every one of us have people in our minds and our hearts that you have brought to those places that we think about when we hear this read. Lord, help us to realize that nothing can separate us from your love for us. Nothing can take that away. And because of the connection that we have through the blood of your Son, Lord, that fellowship of the believers cannot be taken away by any distance or by any physical obstacles, because it's a fellowship of the heart, Lord. Help us to seek after it. Help us to strive for the fellowship. But help us to also realize that when we invest time in one another, when we disciple one another, when we share our faith, Lord, those are the things. Those are the things that are the reward. It's that fellowship, Lord. We thank you for the fellowship. We thank you that you created us to live and to be, to thrive in community, Lord, whether we are physically with one another or not. And Lord, I pray for any of those out there who are struggling right now, who are struggling with this feeling of being alone or feeling like they do not, they don't have the connection that they desire, Lord, with other believers right now. Lord, help them to be encouraged by this message this morning. We thank you and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, remember, as always, you are loved.
Silent, our hearts on fire.